concepts and senses are adapted to perceive how heavenly bodies, heavenly circumstances are linked. 0.10. Only because sense perceptible things are nothing other than condensed spirit beings to we human beings, we can lift ourselves up in thought to the level of spirit beings, think about and understand them. Sense perceptible things originate in the spirit world and are simply another manifestation of spirit beings. When we formulate thoughts about things, we are simply inwardly directed away from their sense perceptible forms and toward their spiritual archetypes. Understanding an object by thinking about it is a process that can be compared to melting a solid body to the chemists who study it in its true form. The spiritual archetypes of the sense perceptible world are to be found in the different regions of spirit country. In the 5th, 6th, and 7th regions, they still exist as living germinal points, while in the 4 lower regions they take shape as spiritual formations. When the human spirit tries to come to an understanding of sense-perceptible objects by means of thinking, it perceives shadowy copies or imitations of spiritual formations. In Aspiring 2, 10, Johannes Kepler, 1571-1630. This passage is from the commentary on his book Astronomia Nova, Part 2, Chapter 7. 54. 150 Theosophy. A spiritual understanding of our surroundings, we raise the question of how spiritual formations condense into sense perceptibility. To our sensory perception, the world around us is divided into 4 clearly distinguishable levels, the mineral, plant, animal and human levels. The mineral kingdom is perceived by means of the senses and understood by means of thinking. When we formulate a thought about a mineral object, we are dealing with 2 things, the sense-perceptible object and the thought. Accordingly, we must imagine this sense-perceptible thing as a condensed thought being. Now, one mineral entity acts out from beyond another, it bumps into it and makes it move, warms it, illuminates it, dissolves it, and so on. This outward way of working can be expressed in thought. In the process of having thoughts about how mineral objects influence each other in a regular and lawful manner, our isolated thoughts expand into a thought image of the whole mineral world. This thought image is a reflection of the archetype of the entire mineral sense-perceptible world, and can be found as a whole in the spiritual world. In the plant kingdom, the phenomena of growth and reproduction are added to the fact that one thing outwardly affects another. Plants grow and produce beings of the same kind, so life is added to what we encounter in the mineral kingdom. Simply pondering this state of affairs will lead us to a point of view that sheds light on the subject. Each plant possesses the inherent power to create its own living form and to pass it on to a being of its own kind. The forms of crystals stand midway between minerals. The three rules 151. Substances of the form of source, such as those we encounter in gases, liquids, and so on, and the living form of the plant world. In crystals we find the transition from the formless mineral world to the living capacity of the plant kingdom to produce form. The outward sense-perceptible process of assuming shape, as it takes place in both the mineral and plant kingdom, must be seen as a sense-perceptible conversation of a purely spiritual process that occurs when the spiritual terminal points of the three upper regions of the country of spirit beings develop into the spirit formations of the lower regions. The spiritual archetype of crystallization is the transition from a formless spirit germ point to a spiritual formation with a shape. If this transitional process condenses to the point where our senses can perceive its result, it manifests in the sense-perceptible world as the process of mineral crystallization. In the plant world, too, a spirit germ that has assumed form is present, but in this case the form being retains the living sculptural ability that the crystal spirit germ lost when it took on shape, exhausting its life in the formation it produced. In contrast, plants possess both form and the ability to go on forming. This characteristic of spirit germs is retained from the spiritual world's upper regions. Thus, a plant is both form, like the crystal, and formative force. In addition to the form that archetypal beings assume in the shape of the plant is also worked upon by another form that bears the imprint of spirit beings from the upper regions. However, the only aspect of the plant that is sense-perceptible is what expresses itself in the completed form, the formative beings. 152 Theosophy. That this is form its life are present within the plant kingdom without being perceptible to our senses. Our physical eyes can see moon that is first small, then larger, but we cannot see the sculpting force that makes it grow. This sculpting force being is the invisibly active component in the plant kingdom. one level in order to work in the realm of formation. If we call the archetypal forms that have not assumed a specific shape the first elemental kingdom, then the force beings that are invisible to our senses and that work in sculpting the growth of plants belong to the second elemental kingdom. In the animal world, the ability to grow and reproduce is augmented by sensations and impulses. These are manifestations of the soul world. Any being endowed with them belongs to the soul world, which receives impressions from it and exerts an influence on it. Now, every sensation or impulse that comes about in an animal is brought up from the depths of the animal's soul. However, the animal's form is more lasting than these sensations or impulses. We might say that the animal's sentient activity compares to its more permanent and enlivened form as the changeable form of a plant compares to the fixed form of a crystal. The plant, so to speak, is totally taken up with the force that sculpts forms. It continues to incorporate different forms throughout its life as it produces first roots, then leaves, then flowers, and so on. In contrast, the animal has a finished form within which it develops an ever-changing life of sensations and impulses. This life exists in the soul world. Plants grow and reproduce, while the three worlds 153. Animals perceive, feel, and develop impulses. For the animal, these impulses are something formless that evolves through every new form. Ultimately, the archetypal processes of these impulses are to be found in the highest regions of the country of spirit beings, as they are active and at work in the soul world. In animals, then, in addition to the force beings invisibly at work directing growth and reproduction, others are also present that have descended one stage deeper into the soul world. In the animal kingdom, sensations and impulses are crafted by formless beings who are simply the soul garment. These are the actual architects of animal forms. In spiritual science, the realm to which they belong can be called the third elemental kingdom. Inferior beings are equipped not only with the same ability characteristic of plants and animals, but also with the ability to develop sensations into concepts and thoughts and to govern our impulses and thinking. Thus, which appears as form in plants and as soul faculties in animals, appears in human beings in its real form, as God itself. Animals are souls, human beings are spirits. The spirit being shapes the soul of an animal, and a human being, who ascends one step further into the sense-perceptible world of matter itself. The spirit is present in sense-perceptible guard within the physical human body and telepathy only as the spirit being's pattern is adjusted as God represents it. The spirit appears within a human being under conditions imposed by the physical organization of his or her brain. However, it also becomes the inner being of a human individual. 154 Theology. In human beings, the form assumed by the formless spirit being is God, while in plants it assumes the guise of form and in animals, that of the soul. Therefore, to the extent that we humans are thinking beings, there is no elemental kingdom building us up from outside. In our sense-perceptible body, and only to the extent that we are formed as sentient beings, the elemental beings work on us in the way they work on plants and animals. Our thought organization, however, is worked on only from within our physical body. In our spiritual organs, in our nervous system which dominates the perceptive brain, we are confronted in sense-perceptible form with what works imperceptibly, as a force being, our plants and animals. This means that animals see themselves, which human beings are conscious of themselves. In animals, the spirit experiences itself as soul but has not yet grasped itself as spirit. In human beings, however, the spirit recognizes itself as such, although physical circumstances permit it to appear only as a shadowy reflection of the spirit as God. Accordingly, the threefold growth falls into the following subdivision. The kingdom of archetypal formless beings, first elemental kingdom. 2. The kingdom of soul created beings, second elemental kingdom. 3. The kingdom of soul beings, third elemental kingdom. The three worlds 155. IV. The kingdom of created forms, crystal forms beings. The kingdom of sense perceptible forms worked on by the soul creating beings, fourth kingdom. C. The kingdom of sense-perceptible forms worked on by both the form-creating beings and the beings that express themselves as soul animal kingdom. Eight. The kingdom of sense-perceptible forms worked on by form-creating and soul beings, and in which the spirit appears in the sense-perceptible world as the form of God's human being. This demonstrates how the constitutional form of the body is the universe of the body. The ether body, the sentient soul body and mind. comes about through the condensation of the human archetype to the point of sense perceptibility. So we can also call this physical body a being of the first elemental feeling condensed to the level of physical perceptibility. The ether body comes about when a form of the same origin remains local, such as a being that extends its activity into the realm of sense perceptibility and does not become perceptible itself. To characterize this being human, we must say that it does its ultimate origin to a higher treatment of the senses. 55.
Things that formerly, when you last appeared alive,
insight into what is perceived from our senses, we expand our own being in such a way that our life prior to this expansion seems to have been spent dreaming about the world. See, thought forms in the human aura. It has been said that the formations of any one of the three worlds are real for its own use because the faculties or organs needed to perceive them. For example, certain processes taking place in space are perceptible to us as manifestations of light only because we have problems with our eyes. So much of what is real actually becomes evident to any being depends on that same degree of receptivity. We are never justified in saying that all of what we are told is real. If many things can be real, but we simply lack the organs to perceive them. The soul and spirit worlds are just as real as the sense of our sensual world, in fact, being real in a much higher sense. No physical eye can see feelings and concepts, but 58. 160 Theosophy. They are real nonetheless. We encounter the phenomena of the physical world through our outer senses, similarly, feelings, impulses, instincts, thoughts, and so on become perceptions for our spirits and organs. Having soul and spirit through phenomena become perceptions by means of our inner senses is analogous to how certain processes in space are perceived as colors. Of course, the full meaning of this statement can be later on learned by those who have developed their inner senses by following the path the artist described in the next chapter. For such people, the soul phenomena of the soul environment and the spiritual phenomena of the spiritual realm become supersensitive and visible. They experience another being's feelings as raying out toward them like rays of light. When they turn their attention to other thoughts, these thoughts radiate through spiritual space. For them, one person's thought about another person is not invisible, it is a perceptible process. The actual content of a thought exists only in the mind of the thinker, but it produces effects on the spiritual realm, and it is this process that is perceptible to the spiritual eye. The thought is a natural reality streaming out from one person toward the other, and how it affects the other person is experienced as a perceptible process in the spiritual world. For someone with open spiritual senses, then, the physically perceptible person is only one part of the whole human being. The physical person is the center of soul and spirit in the stream. It is impossible to be more here than merely hinted to richly bearing the notion that feeling is itself unclear. For example, a thought that is otherwise alive only in us. Discrete world 161. Listeners' understanding appears as a spiritually perceptible lower phenomenon, which comes corresponding to the character of the thought. A thought stemming from a person's sensual impulses has a different hint than one formulated in the service of pure knowledge, noble beauty, or eternal truth. Thoughts springing from sensual activity move through the soul world in shades of red, while a thought that elevates the thinker to a higher form of knowledge appears in a beautiful shade of light yellow. One that stems from loving devotion discloses itself in a radiant rose 2.11 or supersensible manifestation of a thought expresses its degree of exactitude as well as its content. A thinking mind's precise thought appears as a formation with distinct contours, while a confused idea appears as a blurred and foggy formation. In this way, a person's soul and spirit nature appear as the supersensitive portion of a total human being. These spiritually perceptible colors, which surround an active physical human being like an egg-shaped cloud, constitute the person's aura. The size of this aura varies from person to person, but on the average we may imagine a whole person to be about twice as tall and four times as broad as his or her physical body. However, there are also some lasting basics. 11. of regular form and distinct limits. In the aura of a person suddenly seems to fear, he noticed wavy strikes of blue with a reddish blue shimmer moving from top to bottom. The aura of someone who is tensely awaiting some particular event has red blue strikes constantly radiating from inside outward. 67, 68, 166 options.
Part of the aura is revealed, showing the extent of that individual and the citizen of the spiritual
considered part of the aura, an individual's divine self radiates into the open world. To the extent that individuals give evidence of this aura, they are claimed to use by the divinity that lights them heal, but this part of the aura takes to the extent in which they work out of the eternal. Supreme Rule 169. True, beautiful and good, rather than out of themselves, they essentially stay arrested from their narrower selves to capacity to offer themselves up on the great altar of cosmic activity. 75 thus led individuals have made themselves in the course of their incarnation from destruction in their origin.